So I had something written down for Lucian to introduce him, but I must just know Lucian well enough to introduce him on my own. So our last speaker is Lucian Villasenor. He's a member of the International Socialist Organization. He's also an active organizer with the People's Task Force. I believe he's going to be talking about the case against the police. So welcome, Lucian.
On August 28th, Shannon J. Miles shot and killed Harris County Sheriff's Deputy during Guilford. Despite no known connection between Shannon and the Black Lives Matter movement, police leaders and politicians wasted no time in trying to draw connections between Guilford's murder and the growing movement for black liberation in the U.S. Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick issued a statement saying Texans should start calling our officers sir and ma'am all the time. It's a show of respect they deserve, and that people need to change this negative attitude towards the police that protect us and show appreciation for law enforcement. Tonight, I want to make the case against the police and argue that for black lives truly matter, as today's movement demands, the most basic structures of ruling class power in capitalist society, starting with the racist police and the injustice system, but not stopping there, need to be uprooted and completely transformed. It's important that we have this conversation because police reform and police abolition can lead to very different strategies in our movement work. Some argue that the violations and atrocities being witnessed across the country are rogue acts committed by a few bad apples. But as more cases of police brutality and murder come to light, it becomes clear that these aren't just a few bad apples. It's a system that's rotten to the core. As soon as the US government began dismantling the welfare state in the late 1970s, there was a corresponding increase in the size of the police force and the number of prisons in this country. They hadn't solved any of the problems of the welfare. They hadn't solved any of the problems that the welfare state was designed to solve. There were still poor people, unequal schools, unemployment, etc. But the welfare state was dismantled anyway, in a process we now call neoliberalism. And what's become clear is that the way the U.S. is planning to manage the crisis that neoliberalism has created is by using the police and prisons to crack heads rather than deliver services to people. In the current context, we can see local police forces being deployed to deal with gentrification, unemployment, and poverty, and then put those people increasingly in the overcrowded correctional facilities. So while the police have always been racist and brutal, the recent increase in black people getting shot is directly related to the economic crisis, and the housing crisis of 2008. For decades, the working class has been under attack. As we see social services cut, unemployment skyrocket, and wealth concentrated into fewer and fewer individuals. Between 2009 and 2012, the richest 1% saw their real income soar by 34.7%, while the bottom 99% only saw a 0.8% gain. In other words, 90% of all real income gains went to the 1%. Some 42% of all U.S. workers earn less than $15 an hour. More than half of African Americans are in that category, as are 60% of Latinos. Among women of all races, 55% are paid hourly wages below the $15 mark. On top of all this comes a tremendous hit to working class wealth, which is almost exclusively tied to the value of homes. Since September 2008, some 5 million homes have gone into foreclosure. According to Jamel Bowie, Slate's chief political correspondent, in 2005, 3 years before the Great Recession, the median black household had a net worth of $12,000. Yes, this was far behind the median white household, which had a net worth of $134,000, but it was a huge improvement from previous decades, in which housing discrimination made wealth accumulation difficult, if not impossible, for the large majority of African American families. By the official end of the recession in 2009, median household net worth for blacks had fallen to $5,677, a generation's worth of hard work and progress wiped out. In addition to that, 15% of homeowners whose houses are valued under $200,000 are underwater, meaning they owe more on loans than their homes are worth. The new debt bomb in the U.S. is student loans, which have gone from around $500 billion in 2005 to more than $1.2 trillion today. As capitalism adapts and the ruling class continues to squeeze profits out of workers, they need institutions like the police to reorganize society and keep people under control. As we saw during the Occupy movement, people began taking the streets to demand changes to the vast inequalities between the 1% and the 99%. But it was the police who were used to crack down nationwide on encampments and organizers in an attempt to quell the burgeoning movement. When the police aren't organized into squads in order to shut down demonstrations, they're dispersed throughout the city to police the daily life of the poor and working class. That's the distinctive dual function of the modern police. The dispersed surveillance and intimidation done on a routine basis in the name of fighting crime, and the concentrated form designed to combat working class self-activity, such as strikes, riots, or demonstrations. Just like we saw in Ferguson, Missouri, as everyday people stood up against the racist murder of 18-year-old Mike Brown. The police are also the foot soldiers for immigration enforcement, with programs like Secure Communities, which directly link local law enforcement with federal agencies. Police are picking up undocumented folks for cursory offenses, like running a stoplight or forgetting to use your blinker, and then handing them over to federal agents for deportation. Travis County has one of the highest deportation rates in the country, deporting on average 19 people a day. Sometimes entire families are rounded up and placed in detention centers, where they face abysmal living conditions and sexual harassment. Just a few days ago, Blanca Boriego went into a Houston gynecological office under the pretense that she was getting her annual exam. Instead, the staff sprung local law enforcement on her as she was led out of the office in handcuffs in front of her two daughters, the younger of whom was 8 years old. One important discussion in our movement, though, has to be about drawing out the analysis into larger ideas of solidarity. For instance, there's been a debate in our movement about the use of Black Lives Matter, of Brown Lives Matter, or Muslim Lives Matter as slogans because they detract from the message of Black Lives Matter. We should challenge that. The idea behind Muslim Lives Matter is that law enforcement, especially the FBI, use racial profiling to target Muslims and Arabs. The idea behind Brown Lives Matter is that law enforcement, especially immigration and customs enforcement, target Latinos. The consequences of both is that racism is on the rise and that people die. In fact, various agencies of the police are the sharpest edge of multiple kinds of racism in our society. And by drawing these connections, we can see the same people have their roots on all our throats. We ought to draw greater connections in our movements so that we can grow stronger together. The day-to-day violence inflicted upon the working class by the state is not random, but calculated, and serves the purpose to demoralize and restrict any kind of fightback. If we want to see an end to this regime and build an alternative, we must organize. When I say organize, that means we need to get people in the room, just like we're doing tonight, so we can plan campaigns and hash out issues together. Locally, we must debate and discuss a set of demands, both long and short term. Locally, we must debate and discuss a set of demands that fulfill both long and short-term demands of the movement. The demands don't have to be exhaustive, but they should be coherent enough that we have a renewed sense of what we're fighting for at the current moment. These can include demands that focus on enforcement of existing policies that are intended to curb police violence, including massive fines against departments and the defunding and closing of police precincts. To further that, we can disarm the police and advocate for the removal of firearms and tasers across departments. There's much experience to draw from the many local campaigns people have been engaged in before and since the eruption of the Black Lives Matter movement. How did activists win the struggle for reparations for victims of police torture in Chicago? How did activists pressure courts to sanction the NYPD's practice of stop and frisk? How did activists in California pressure win the ban on grand juries in cases involving police shootings of civilians? How have activists organized to dramatically curtail the use of the death penalty in the U.S.? How did activists in Austin get the first indictment towards an officer for killing an unarmed person of color in over a decade? As the right wing unites with police leaders in the concerted attack on the Black Lives Matter movement, now is the time for more organization, communication, and coordination to learn from different parts of the movement that have had some successes and even failures that the rest of us can learn from. History has taught us that the future and the hope of attaining a more just and equitable society is tied with the Black struggle. C.L.R. James, the Trinidad-born socialist active in the U.S. in the 1930s and 40s, explained why in a 1948 speech to a group of U.S. socialists. We say, number one, that the Negro struggle, the independent Negro struggle, has a vitality and validity of its own. that it has deep historic roots in the past of America and in present struggles. It has an organic political perspective, along which it is traveling, to one degree or another, and everything shows that at the present time, it's traveling with great speed and vigor. We say, number two, that the independent Negro movement is able to intervene with terrific force upon the general social and political life of the nation, despite the fact that it is waged under the banner of democratic rights and is not led necessarily either by the organized labor movement or the Marxist Party. We say, number three, and this is the most important, that it is able to exercise a powerful influence upon the revolutionary proletariat, that it has got a great contribution to make to the development of the proletariat of the United States, and that it is in itself a constituent part of the struggle for socialism. James' words echo through to today. The eruption of Black Lives Matter has exposed for all to see the reality of a racist barbarism in a supposedly post-racial society, and has already helped shape a new radicalization and a new left that will fight for future struggles for justice. I hope we can talk about how we'll organize that fight back, and I look forward to the discussion following. Thank you.